A quick thank you to the T5 peeps. Bob the Dragon, Data Magnet, Cat Crab Lobster, Dark Machine, Estrella the Dreamer, Mezik, Feudic Yol, Casper Arnholtz, and Chaos to Mist. Thank you very much. Story number 1. Made to Order, written by Glitch Key. Let me get this straight. You're saying nothing was an accident?
No, not in general. Just, where you're concerned.
Okay. Could you take it from the top again?
Where do you want me to start this time?
Let's skip the intergalactic shenanigans. Stick to us.
Understood, huh? To start, we've been here since before your planet even existed. We found your star as it was coalescing into an accretion disk. And we started our work then.
Yeah, I got that.
We guided the process as the planets began to form. Slung one of them into yours to destabilize it and throw it off axis.
Why?
We needed a death world, something inherently unstable, that does whatever it can to kill life.
Yeah, sure. Then what?
We seeded it. Basic stuff. Singular cell, compatible with galactic standard.
Sure. Galactic standard, and then?
We guided it. Brought it here and there. Protected promising developments. Guided things forward.
Protected. How many extinctions was that?
More of them. Well, all but the last. That was all you.
Yeah, okay, ship the blame.
There's only so much we did. When your species showed promise, our interference became more direct, more, pointed.
Your race is indirectly responsible for more of our dead than anything or anyone else.
Indeed. But we need you to develop quickly. And it was the only way, short of direct uplift, and that wouldn't work.
Why not?
Because we needed you the way you were. Vicious, cruel, cunning, wise, caring. You're the greatest predators in the galaxy. The most protective friends. Your race is everything that we aren't.
And why would you need that, exactly?
We needed something that could not just survive the worst death world that we could design, but, dominate it.
We needed something that could take the worst blows possible and throw them in the face of whatever threw them. Why?
Your race, like many others, has asked a question of themselves ever since their first conscious thoughts. Why are we here? What is our purpose?
Yeah, so?
Your race is perhaps the only one to have a definitive answer to that question. You're here because we designed you. Your purpose, humanity's purpose, is to save the galaxy from whatever darkened our skies. Your race is too young to have seen the galaxies that vanish under the Horde, but you're here to stop it. End of story. Story number 2. Happy as a human in a blood sport. Written by Chapathing.
It's fighting time here at the 300th annual Apex Fighter Tournament. I am your host, Gorto Zanzi, presenting you live from the Centauri Prime Expo Station. We've got an amazing lineup for you today, folks. It's been a busy, uplifting year, and we have a lot of new faces to get to know. There's a buzz in the arena today, and some of our fans are literally hanging from the rafters in excitement. In just a few moments, the tournament will begin. 64 fighters, one winner, and a weekend you will not want to miss. 8 fights and 2 fatalities later. It's been one hell of a night so far, and we're more than halfway through the qualifying rounds. Next up, Ned Henderson from Earth. He's a bipedal mammalian with no fur. In Earth's unit, he's 6 feet and 1 inch and weighs 200 pounds. But in our more civilized units, he's 50 ipix and weighs 1.4 gragix. He is in the lightweight category of this year's game. Opposing him will be Mamorak Squawkhawk, representing the fighter families of the dear Capron viewers and listeners. Mamorak is 45 ipix and weighs 1.3 gragix, but as talent, so he's bumped up from the super lightweight, because we don't want a repeat of our 5th annual game. Hold a convention tri-cam footage of Kefron standing exhausted in a ring literally painted in blood. Reptilian remains still twitching occasionally as they are mopped up. Henderson raises his arms in what we think is a defensive posture, but he could be surrendering, we're not sure. Squawkhawk jumps right, Henderson stays still and bobs on his feet. Squawkhawk prepares his talons. Henderson goes for the back kick, Squawkhawk tries to dodge, but the foot went through! Oh my god! I repeat, the foot went through! I don't think Capron's neck bends that way. The paramedic is in the ring now, and we're getting reports. Ladies and gentlemen, Squawkhawk is dead. We apologize to our fans for having a short match. We'll be upgrading Henderson to heavyweight. End of round one. The remains of the last contestant are removed with a vacuum. The fighting pit increases from boxing rings to the size of a tennis court. Ladies and gentlemen and ethereal beings, we're getting ready for the next round of eliminations. We've already seen who has the guts to make it to round two. Now, let's see who still has the guts to make it to round three. Up first, we have Ned Henderson against Eldwack Smashhead, reigning champion for two consecutive years. Weighing over 5 Gragax and with 2 sets of arms, Eldak is representing the Thargak race with a terrifying 80% mortality rate. How will a small human compare? Let's find out! Uldak throws the referee out the ring and charges Henderson. Henderson jumps out of the way. Those oversized leg muscles are really coming in handy right about now. But how long can he avoid Uldak? Uldak lunges for the grapple, but Henderson bends his back. He's bent his spine and rolls out of the way. Is Henderson injuring himself to bend like that? He's not, ladies and gentlemen. He is not, ladies and gentlemen, and sentient clouds. Even with all that muscle mass, the human is still agile. What a display. Aldwak lunges again, and Henderson avoids the attack. Henderson moves forward and punches Aldak in the sternum, but it is no good. It's going to take more than that to get through Targrek Hyde. How much longer can Henderson hold out? 20 minutes later. What am I seeing, ladies and gentlemen, and any observing hive mind entities, is astounding. We are 20 minutes into a match, and Henderson is still not giving up. He's jumping, he's bending his spine in ways that makes me uncomfortable, and he's not letting Aldak perform his signature death squeeze. Aldak is not looking good now. He's panting as hard as he can, but everyone can see that he's overheating. Uldak is struggling on his feet. He's not lunging. He's not swinging. He's just taking it. Henderson is all over Thargak now. Henderson thrusts his fist forward in surprising force. Oh, that looks like it hurts. Uldak is struggling. Wait, wait. He's down. He's down. The human newcomer has defeated Uldak. Paramedics are examining Uldak now. He's trying to get up, but there is blood everywhere. Aldak's heart has literally exploded from overexhaustion. I'm just getting word now. Yes, the paramedic was caught in the explosion as well. The giant corpse with the gaping hole where its heart used to be is dragged off the arena by a hover forklift with a mangled Capron corpse stacked on top. An underpaid janitor hoses off the arena with an antiseptic foam and rinses it away. 3 rounds of elimination, 1 lethal debate, and a disemboweling later. Well, folks, we're down to the finals here as newcomer and crowd favorite Ned Henderson prepares to face off against the terror from the Nomicon Beta 7, the 8-legged legend herself, Yusakiri Zaschik. At a height of 74 apex, she dwarfs the human, and while she has signed a waiver saying that she won't liquefy competitors' organs with a venom, that has not stopped her before. The arena is set for the ultimate Apex Fighter finale. There are platforms, bodies of water, and debris strewn around the arena. Arachnid with an armored plate spanning silk-producing abdomen against a mammal who can excrete waste heat through water pores. Seems even enough to me. Yusakiri and Ned enter the arena on opposite sides. Between them is a deep body of water with floating platforms. On each side is an elevated columns making the whole arena floor uneven. Yusakiri lunges forward, hissing as she goes. What a terrifying spectacle to behold. Henderson climbs onto one of the platforms. I really don't blame him. Yusakiri is having none of it and has climbed after him. Henderson punches Yusakiri. Her chitin takes an impact, but she stumbles back. Henderson backs away from Yusakiri. He's on the ground now. He's picked up a stick. He's holding it like a weapon. Yusakiri uses her silk to pull the stick out of Henderson's hands. Henderson holds on. He's holding the ground and not letting go. Yusakiri pulls harder, but Henderson is not backing down. Wait, He let go. Oh no! It's all over for the... The stick hits Yasukiri! She pulled it straight towards her. She's stunned. Henderson goes for a jumping kick. He hits her in the chest. She's knocked backwards by the blow, but Okaitan takes the brunt of it. Henderson runs around to get to her back, but she's far too fast on her eight legs. Yasukiri stabs at Henderson with one of her legs. Henderson grabs the stick and he's wrapped Yasukiri's leg together with a silk-covered stick. This is an amazing improvised tool use. Yasukiri is stumbling, trying to get her footing, but Henderson is on top of her and has her in a chokehold with the stick. She stabbed out, "Ladies and gentlemen, the human has won the tournament!" And that's the tournament, folks. Humans take home their first victory while the others will mourn their defeat or sacrifice them, as the case may be. This is Gato Zanzi of the Century Prime Expo Center saying good night and stay tuned for our next tournament. Alpha Centauri has talent, or else. End of story.